Hey everyone, happy new year. It's Nakul from Wicky. Welcome Jacob from Trypod to preview the NFL this week.
Happy new year, mate. Exciting time of year. 1 week to go in the NFL. It's gone by fast.
Yep, awesome. Well, I'm actually finally going to get back to Sydney just in time to actually get into it a lot more. At a good time zone getting into the finals. But how's everything been in the world of the NFL?
Yeah, it's very exciting. All the kind of regular season awards markets are really fun to track. And unfortunately, that Dak Prescott tip that I gave many weeks ago, he went from $21 into $240. I would tip he might end up with the second most votes, might finish in second. And I think he is the second favorite in some places. But the problem is that the first place favorite is now $1.05, Lamar Jackson. In fact, he's an interesting talking point for the first game that I'm going to discuss, which we can't share any markets for. There's game markets, but there's no player props up yet. So I want to talk about this game nonetheless. Now, usually on a Wednesday night, we chat about the upcoming Thursday night football for NFL. But because it is week 18, it's the final week of the season, nobody's playing Thursday night football. That would be too much of an advantage leading into the playoffs. However, there are a couple of games on Saturday in America, which is Sunday, Australia. So even if you are back at work Sunday, you do get a couple of games that you can catch. And I do want to make people aware of what's at stake and the context around this game between two storied rivals in the Steelers at Ravens, because the Ravens have been probably the best team in the league this year and has certainly emerged the last couple of weeks, smashing a couple of other contenders. And they've locked up the number one seed. And if you're not well initiated with the NFL, you might be wondering why it would be the Steelers, who are just 9-8, who are $1.50 and 3.5 point favorites on the road at Baltimore. And that is because Baltimore has nothing to gain from this match. So they are locked into the number one seed. Therefore, it's highly likely that players are going to be rested. The Steelers, on the other hand, a win gets them to 10 wins. It gets them in a wild card position. They will need a result or two to fall the next day to get them into the playoffs, but they're very possible results. So the Steelers definitely will play like their season depends on it. And the Ravens, well, they are bitter rivals of the Steelers. They would love to kick them out of the playoffs, but they don't have anything tangible they can gain. So my instinct is I can only play the favorite. Like, I only want the team that's going to pour everything in, and I don't want the team where motivation is questionable. But it is funny, you know, I do want to give some historical context too. These two, because they are division rivals, they play twice a year, and often they do play the final game of the season. They met in the exact same circumstances in 2019, and it was the Ravens locked into a bye, and it was the Steelers needing to win to make the playoffs. And I remember back then betting on the Steelers, and the Ravens, with their second team, still won 28-10. And they were like a touchdown underdog. So that gives you some insight that the Ravens rested everybody back in 2019, still won anyway. But what's interesting as well is that the Ravens in 2019 went on, had the bye, and then came out of the bye and lost. And so this is an interesting question, and I'm wondering what you think about this, Nakul. Like, say it's the final game of the rugby league, because it's pretty similar, comparable fit level of physicality and similar level of contact sport. But in the NRL, we don't have a bye for anybody before the finals. In the NFL, the number one seed gets a bye. So there's the argument that while the Ravens have nothing to gain, they could play hard maybe for a portion of this one, because they don't want to get too rusty, that if you sit people out in week 18, then you're idle in the first week of the playoffs, and then you're playing a super important playoff game 2 weeks later, but it could actually be 3 weeks since you've played a meaningful game. So there's the argument that the Ravens might still pour a bit into this one, and that's where it gets a bit more tricky. But what do you think? Like, do you believe in kind of carrying momentum, rest, rust, or is it just more important than anything to avoid injuries?
I'm on the side of avoiding injuries. I think, like, if it's if you're playing like snooker or golf or something, yeah, okay, fine. Maybe,
or even cricket.
If you're playing cricket and if you're a batsman or a spin bowler, I'd say play on, not like a higher chance of injury. But if you're a bowler and you're sprinting in like a Brett Lee type of guy, I always, and obviously with contact sport, I always lean on the side of just rest them. Like, they should be mentally be able to get up for a big game. And from a physical point of view, these guys are like perfectly tuned athletes. So I guess I'm always on that side. Even with rugby league, like, I could not believe, I think it was the Panthers didn't rest a few players round 27 for this year from memory.
That's true.
I thought that was crazy.
Yes.
So I'm always on the side of resting.
They, thinking back to the Panthers, they knew that if they won, they'd win the minor premiership. So you could say that there was something there to achieve, but there have been times when players have played when literally they can't change their seeding position. Now, as I said, it gets more complicated because it is a rival. You don't really want to just roll over at home and let your rival knock you about in your own house. And the fact that they do have the week off next week anyway. But I think what it comes back to is injuries this time of year, so impactful on the playoff race and in the playoffs is who got through the season. The Ravens have already lost their first choice running back. They've already lost their first choice tight end. I feel like you just don't risk playing your starters for long, if at all, and that risk of an injury that could hamper you in the playoffs more than anything. However, if the starters are going to play, it would be the first quarter or first half. So I would actually say if you give the Ravens any chance, kind of as an underdog, you've got to only play them first half or first quarter. Because if they're in front or they're covering the line, that's great. But there's a greater magnitude chance that the best players are going to come out after halftime. And that's if they play at all, right? And I think for a value play, you may even look at a Ravens halftime, Steelers full-time, because you know that the Steelers are going to fight to the death. Their season depends on it, but you don't know how long into the game these Ravens might be playing hard. So that's not on the odds comparison tool, because that's the odds comparison tool is going to pick up player props, but that is halftime, full-time, people should be aware that they can find that mark on a lot of bookies. And I did see 825 on Top Sport was the best odds available. So I just thought that was an extra kind of bonus play that I could share. If you're looking for a player prop, obviously just wait a bit longer. The bookies actually can put Steeler props up, but it seems to be they've just not released anything because of the uncertainty around the Ravens for now. So it is one of those wait and see. Of course, as I said, it's not kicking off till Sunday morning Aussie time. But after that, there is a second game, a second Saturday night / Sunday day Aussie time encounter. Also really important and exciting, and also division rivals. It's the Texans at the Colts, and the Texans are actually slight favorites. These two sides were two of the worst in the league last year. I think second worst and fourth worst records last season, but coming to this game, both with a chance to make the playoffs. In fact, both with the chance to still win their division and host a playoff game. So that makes this one a massive one. In terms of winning the division, they're going to have to see Jacksonville lose the next day, but they certainly know that winning gets a foot in the door in the playoffs. So it's kind of an all or nothing match because the loser is definitely out of this one. For what it's worth, I lean to the Colts. So that's going to inform my player prop betting decisions. I know the Texans have the better quarterback. Obviously, Stroud is back. He's going to win Offensive Rookie of the Year. But I do feel like Indy's a more complete side, and I do give that edge for home field. So if I'm looking for an Indianapolis player for a touchdown, there's a couple I want to talk about. The first touchdown, I like Michael Pittman. He's been out a few weeks with an injury, but he returned last week, and Minshew sure was looking for him. Plenty of targets, plenty of catches last week without scoring a touchdown, but plenty of yardage. And Pittman's been the by far the number one option in terms of the passing game when he's been there. And when your season's on the line, you're going to put it in the hands of your best players. So I'm looking at first touchdown at $13. I think you can toggle to that, Nakul.
Yep.
If that's still the best available. Yeah, $13 in a couple of different locations. But again, Jonathan Taylor, he's a lot shorter, $5.50 best price, because he's the most likely to score. But if you do go back, Taylor's also for the Colts, and he's the running back, and he's getting 20 carries a game since he's been back from his contract holdout. You're going to also notice a very good price there about his anytime. It even makes me, okay. I even feel like the market value tool probably doesn't emphasize how big of a difference that is. Okay. If we look at Jonathan Taylor anytime touchdown, we're seeing $1.82 on Dabble and next best price, $1.58 on Sportsbet. Now, the market value is saying that's 115%. So I guess that's the numbers don't lie. $1.82 is technically 15% higher than $1.58. But when you get to really low odds, the actual amount that you can win, like that is actually very significant. That's a lot more significant than going from 16-1 to 18-1, going from $1.60 to $1.80. So I really think that that is appealing and that is really solid. And whether you plug that into a same gamer, we'll just play that as a single. Jonathan Taylor for an anytime touchdown, $1.82 is a really good kind of double up play that I like.
I love that. And I'll get greedy as I always do. Anything sort of above, let's just have a look here. So anything from, you know, Pierce above stand out at all? Any of the other plays?
So we're looking anytime.
Yeah, so Pierce, Taylor, Sermon and above.
I was looking at Alec Pierce, yeah. I think as well. Yeah, 460 anytime or 23 first touchdown. But what I came back to is like, you know, his odds are not even double Pittman. But I think Pittman will get double the targets. So sure. I can't really justify, you know, you never really know. And of course, you might only take one target to score a touchdown. But I think the volume's going to go Pittman's way. So then I just think that's your best proposition on the board.
Sweet. And any love for Nico Collins, 10 for first touchdown?
I'm going to look at an Indianapolis player because I'm just thinking Indy's going to get the win here. So that's probably what's going to steer me away. But if the Texans still had Tank Dell, you know, this could be a different game. But I feel like as good as their young quarterback is and he's an absolute stud, not having that game breaker that can take the top off the defense just lowers the ceiling of the whole Texans offense.
Sure. No, fair enough. Awesome. Well, I forgot to say it at the start, but yeah, Google Wiki Linktree, and obviously check out the podcast that we're doing now. The Wiki, the Discord, the odds comparison tools, all that stuff is free. If you just Google Wiki Linktree and for Trypod, Punters Tips Forum, the Facebook group, obviously Jacob's community with over 25,000 people. But yeah, Happy New Year again to everyone. Thanks, Jacob, for coming on again. And we'll catch you all over again this time next week.